Welcome to lecture number 8 of the course Introduction to Data Science. Today we are going to talk about the evaluation of supervised learning problems. In the past couple of weeks we have seen many different techniques ranging from neural networks until decision trees. They all provide supervised learning approaches, very different in nature. However, so far we did not really talk about how to evaluate the quality of such models. For example, if we look at a neural network, we are using backpropagation to continuously improve the network, but that doesn't say very much on how the neural network will perform on unseen data. So this is exactly the topic that we will address today, and this is an outline of what we will talk about. So first we will talk about the need for such techniques. Then we will argue that we need to use unseen data in order to evaluate the result, to avoid things like overfitting. We will also see that you can play with parameters. When, for example, having a classifier, you can put the threshold at a particular level. That's why we introduced the notion of a so-called ROC curve, a very well-known concept in the evaluation of supervised learning problems. And we will discuss different topics, concept drift, A-B testing, dealing with continuous target variables, talking about categorical variables that can have multiple values, confusion matrices, etc. Yeah, so we will try to cover the space in a broad sense. So let's start by explaining why do we need to evaluate? Why can't we not simply take the result that we got from a neural network learning algorithm, from a decision tree learning algorithm? Why do we need to talk about this at all? Well, the point is that all of these techniques, you feed it with descriptive features, a target feature comes out, and by training the model, we try to predict the target feature as good as possible. So that if we later apply this model, then based on the descriptive features, we can predict the target feature. However, if we do this on a certain training data, then it may be that our model performs extremely well on the training data, but if we then apply it in reality, it performs in a very poor way. So that's why we need to have these evaluation techniques, and that is why we need to apply it to unseen data. So this is a table, as we have seen many before. Suppose that our target variable is study result, and we have a bunch of descriptive variables. Now we can learn different models, neural networks, decision trees, SVM, logistic regression. We can apply many, many different techniques that we have seen. And perhaps the model would show that the number of lectures that one is present has a strong impact on the study result. And this seems plausible. And if we have a model saying that, then that seems reasonable. It could also be that based on names, you could build a model that predicts a study result. Here, you may have a model that is able to predict that people named Mary will pass, but it doesn't necessarily mean that if this applies to our training data, it will also apply to our test data. If we start look at dates, then if every date is unique, it's trivial to make a model that performs perfectly well on our training data, but will be very poor if we apply it to fresh data. The problem gets even worse if you start looking at combinations of attributes. The more combinations you take, the more quickly we get unique values. So it's trivial to make models that have a very good score on our training data, but if we then apply it in the real world, it may be very poor. And you could end up with models that, based on the eye color and the city where you were born, will predict whether you have a good study result or not. But of course, the things that are indicated here in red, well, they are very unlikely that these things are the case. And the only way to be sure is that the moment that we have learned a model, that we also apply it to data that we did not use during our training phase. So this is the problem of, let's say, overfitting the data. On the one hand, we do not want to overfit the data, make perfect statements for the data that we use to train the model, but then make very bad, statements for unseen examples. At the same time, we also want to avoid underfitting, that we are not really learning anything from the data. And for example, that we always, so if we have, for example, a classifier which should say whether there is fraud or not, and fraud is very rare, then we could have a model that would simply say there is no fraud. It would always say there is no fraud. The model would not have actually used the data, but would still perform reasonably well. So this is the dilemma that we have, and we want to come to classifiers that work well on unseen data, and we should be very careful how to measure the quality. Because in the example that I said, if we always predict there is no fraud, it may be that we are very accurate, but never detect any fraud. And these are the things that we would like to avoid. So to sketch the problem, if let's say the majority of students is passing, then we could have an underfitting model which would not use any variables and would always say student will pass, versus the other model which corresponds to a very deep and complicated decision tree where all the leaves nodes have very few instances, very few students in them, and where we are using things like color of the eyes, city where you were born, etc., etc. So we want to balance between this overfitting and underfitting, and the techniques that we have described have like mechanisms to do that. So the only way to really test the model is to use test data. So we use training data. Let me switch on my pointer. So we are using training data to train a predictive model. And after we have trained the model, we evaluate the model using data that we did not use during training. This is called test data or unseen data. And then we measure the performance. Sometimes this training data is again split in different things. And typically one could also think about validation data, which is used to decide when to stop. I'll come back to that. So let's just assume that we have, a binary classification problem, as you said here. It's an example from the book. So we are trying to predict spam. So spam is positive, ham is negative. And for example, if we look at the first instance, in reality it was spam, but we did not detect it, we predicted ham. So then we have a false negative. If we take a look, for example, at instance 10, then we, in reality, it was a spam message, and we also predicted it was a spam message, and that's a true positive. So we can talk about the actual value being positive or negative, spam or not spam, and the predicted value, again, being positive or negative. And then using this combination, we can talk about true positive, true negative. These are the good values, false positives and false negatives. These are the values that we would like to reduce. So we can simply count these things. So for every row, it corresponds to one of these four. So here I'm highlighting, for example, the true positives. So instance 8 is an example of a true positive, because in reality it was a spam message and we detected that it was a spam message. We have the true negatives, where it was not a spam message, and we also predicted this, so these are good. That's why they are indicated in green. And we have things where there is an error, and there are two types of errors. There is the error where in reality it was a spam message, but we did not detect it. That is a false negative. So we predicted to be negative, but in reality it was a positive. The reverse is called a false positive. So in this case we predicted this positive, but in reality it is negative. So that's how we count these things. And if I apply it to this data set with 20 instances, we see that we have 6 true positives, 9 true negatives, and we have the 2 plus 3 times where we make an incorrect prediction. So this is called the confusion matrix, and that will play a central role in this lecture. And this is actually something that is so simple, and I'm sure that you've seen this before. So now we can compute different metrics using the confusion matrix. We can talk about accuracy. So accuracy are the numbers which are not on are the numbers which are on the diagonal divided by all the numbers. So accuracy would be equal to 6 plus 9 divided by 6 plus 9 plus 2 plus 3. And if we compute that, then that leads to 0.75 as accuracy. Misclassification accuracy, or the fraction not correctly classified, that is this value, and it is exactly the opposite. So these are now the numbers that are not on the diagonal, so 2 plus 3 divided by all the numbers 6 plus 9 plus 2 plus 3, it leads to 0.5. And of course accuracy is 1 minus this value. So this is all I think relatively simple. Sometimes, but typically I will abstract from this, it's also possible that the training set is further refined into a real training set and a validation set. And in that example we have we could talk about partition our data into 3 parts: training set, validation set, test set. So the training set and the validation set is what I refer to as being the training data. You may wonder, and there could be a division, 50% is used for training, 20% is used for validation, 30% is used for testing, and at the bottom you see a 40-20-40 distribution. Why do we sometimes split our training data into, again, 2 smaller sets called training set and validation set here? The reason is that some of the learning techniques do not return one model, but return, let's say, a whole bunch of models, and then the validation set can be used to pick the right model, and so it can be used for model selection if we return multiple results. It can also be used that if we have an algorithm that has a parameter, we can simply train the model using the training set and then evaluate it on the validation set for different parameter settings. And why are we doing that? Because we want to see how it would perform on unseen data. So the validation set is kind of used to ensure that we are not overfitting the data. Another reason for using the validation step is to somehow stop. If we have an iterative approach, then we can stop after a while to avoid that if we would continue, we would start to overfit the data. So the graph here explains the last point. And this could, for example, be that that if we have, let's say, very sophisticated methods with many degrees of freedom, that we have an algorithm which iteratively tries to improve the result on the training set, and after a while, it starts to overfit things that are very specific for this training set. And if you then use a validation set, you can decide the point where you want to stop these iterations. So how to see that? As of example, here you have an iterative approach where in every iteration, the model starts to fit the data better and better and better. And that is indicated by the black line. So this is the performance on our training data. And the more iterations we use, the better the model gets. And if the model has many degrees of freedom, in the end it can just, let's say, perfectly predict the target class by having a very refined model. However, this very refined model may use random things which are very specific for the training set, and should not be used because it would not bring anything if we apply it to real life data. So that's why there is this dashed line, and that is the performance. And as expected, the performance on the validation set is not as good as the performance based on the training set, and that is completely normal. But you can see for a while these two lines are very close to each other, and here you see that it starts to diverge. So you can see that the performance on the validation set gets worse and worse and worse, and this is an indication that we are overfitting the model. In most of what I will talk after this, I will abstract, let's say, from this scenario, and I will only distinguish between training and test. Yeah, so we are not talking about test data here. But sometimes I will briefly, let's say, link to the slides that I just showed. Okay, if we take the simplifying assumption that we have training data and test data, and we abstract from the phenomenon that the training data may also be partitioned into different sets, then there are different ways of testing things. So one of the naive things could be that if you, let's say, separate training data from test data, that you only do that once. And then you get one number for you learn a model based on the training data and you get one number. This is corresponding to what would happen if I would just use the first row, which is called fold one here. I'm using this part to train the model, this whole part, let's say 90%, and I'm using 10% to test. And I could simply do that and stop. But the drawback is that then I get one performance number, namely the performance on this 10% test data. But if it's, I don't know, if our performance is, let's say, so we get an accuracy of 0.9, we do not really know, okay, is it now 0.9 for this test set, or is this fairly robust? So one way to address this is to use k-fold cross-validation, and that means that every instance, so every piece of data, appears in one of the test sets. Typically, the training set is bigger than the test set, but we just repeat the experiment. And if we have 10 folds, then we leave out one tenth for testing, 9/10 we are using for training, and we can do 10 experiments. Why is this useful? I think this example shows that very nicely. So here, just to make it fit on the slide, we are just using 5 folds. I would say that 10 folds is kind of the default way to approach this problem. And if we have 5 folds, I can compute. We train 5 models based on, let's say, 80% of our data. And we evaluate it based on this remaining 10%. And we can do that 5 times. And for each of these 5 experiments, we can compute a confusion matrix, as we have seen before. And we can compute, for example, a quality measure like accuracy. Note that accuracy was defined before, as the number of true positives and the number of true negatives divided by the rest. So in this example, this is 43 plus 38 divided by all the instances in this first test fault. Then we get an accuracy per fault, and we can compute the average. And so the average is more or less the same as if we would have computed it, let's say, over the whole data set. The key thing, however, is that let's say all of these accuracy numbers are in the range, let's say, between 80 and 90. So this gives an indication that the actual accuracy on unseen data will be between 80 and 90%. So we kind of get confidence that our accuracy is somewhere between 80% and 90%. You can do k-fold cross-validation into the extreme, and this is called leave one out cross-validation, where you can think of this as k-fold, where k is equal to the number of instances. This is also called jackknifing. So this is the extreme situation where we use all the data for training except one, and we test it on that one instance. And so our test sets are very small, just a single value, but we have many of them. And again, this can be used to kind of see whether we can build confidence in our results. Bootstrapping is another approach, but it's using the same principle. So now we have k iterations, and in every iteration we randomly select a certain number of instances, called m here, as test instances. And we do this randomly. And we can again repeat the same experiment k times, and then we can see, okay, are now these k experiments leading to similar values when it comes to, for example, accuracy. So this is called bootstrapping, and all of these techniques are designed to also be able to deal with the situation where you don't have a lot of data. One of the complications and one of the things that one should be very careful with is that if we look at data, then data is typically generated by processes that change over time. At the end, we will talk about concept drift in much more detail, but for the moment, it's important to realize that if we have this situation where we have a training set using instances from one time period, and we have a test set using instances from another period, that this will have an effect on the quality of the results that we have. So for example, if the training set is sampled from, I don't know, weekdays, then the test set is sampled from a weekend, there would be severe differences. If we have a process with seasonal effects, if the training set was gathered in autumn and the test set is gathered from winter, perhaps there are also differences. These combinations are kind of sketched here. When doing this, you should be aware of that. So what I'm sketching here is the let's say the separation now in three elements. Like we have the validation set that I explained before. As I said, sometimes we use a validation set, for example, if we generate many models and we would like to pick one, or we need to have a validation set to stop iterating and continuously improve the process. So we have training data, and here in yellow is the test data. This is what we use to, let's say, to evaluate the quality of the algorithm, the quality of the model, and then on unlabeled data, we would like to make a classification. Note that test data is always still labeled, but then we want to apply the model, let's say, in the real world, and then of course we have unlabeled data, because we would like to use the model to make a classification. So if we now add the time dimension, then you can see that there are different strategies possible. So what you see here is that data collected in the years 2015 until 2018, that data is, let's say, split into training, validation, and test data. Note that our test data is covering all 4 years, so does our training data and validation data. And then we make predictions. This situation is different because we use the training and validation based on data over these 3 years, 2015 until 2017. Then we test it on 2018. And then we know that our model has a certain quality. And then we start actually using the model in 2019. This is showing the like a similar scenario where we validate all the time based on, let's say, the most recent period. We do validation to decide parameters, to select models, or to stop iterations, and in the end the goal is to make predictions. But when we make predictions, we are applying the model, and we typically do not know the label, or we know the actual label much later. So this is related to concept drift, and we will come back to that later. Okay, so let's first focus on categorical target features, a bit as I've done before. If we do that and we look at the confusion matrix, then I try to visualize this in this way. So this square corresponds to the instances that are actually positive. So for example, that correspond to spam messages. This square here corresponds to instances that in reality are negative. So if the target is, for example, detect whether somebody has corona, then these are the people that have corona, and these are the people that are not having corona. And then we want to classify things. And here, what is in the red circle is predicted to be positive. And of course, if we would have this situation, it is not good, because there seems to be no relationship between predicting that something is positive and actually being positive, but I use this to explain the numbers. So the errors that we make are the things here, of things that are actually positive, but are not detected as positives. So these are false negatives. Another error are the false positives, and these correspond to instances that are negative, but that are predicted to be positive because they are in this red circle. So these are the things that are visualized in the confusion matrix. And based on these four sets, Fn, Tp, Fp, and Tn, which are very easy to understand, we can define all of these measures. So the true positive rate is Tp divided by Tp plus Fn. So this is, if we look at this square of positive cases, what is the fraction actually classified as being positive? Then we have the true negative rate, Tn divided by Tn plus Fp. So this corresponds to this square, and we look at the fraction that that is actually, let's say, predicted to be negative, and that is actually negative. Yeah? And then we have false negative rate, false positive rate, using, let's say, similar definitions. Note that there is this relationship, TPR, so true positive rate is 1 minus false negative rate. You can check that by simply looking at the formulas. The true negative rate is 1 minus the false positive rate. And if you look at this Venn diagram and you look at the formulas, then that will be clear. We already defined accuracy. So these are the numbers in green. indicating by divided by all the instances, misclassification is 1 minus accuracy. This is all simple and easy to understand, but perhaps you want to write down these terms in such a way that later you can also interpret them properly. Related, but also slightly different, is our precision and recall. If we look at precision, we look at the fraction TP divided by TP plus FP. So we look at the red circle, so the cases which we predict to be positive, and of the cases that we predict to be positive, we look at the fraction that is actually positive. So that's what's called precision. Recall corresponds to, we now look at all positive instances, and we look at TP, what is indicated here in green, divided by all the instances that are actually positive. And note that recall is exactly the same as true positive, right? And so these things are obviously connected. If you are familiar with information retrieval, you may recognize these terms. So if I would translate this to, let's say, analyzing a search engine like Google, then precision would be, if we type a search query, what is the fraction of the results that we get back that are actually about the topic that we were searching for? And so that is this situation. So what is inside the red circle? We have typed a query. What is inside the red circle are the search results that Google returns to us. And then precision corresponds to the fraction of the search results that we get back that actually correspond to the query that we have. Recall is something different. So we type a search query and we look at the fraction of the pages that match our search query that are actually being returned. Yes? Hopefully this helps to remember what I mean. Well, I can now apply all of these different things. So we have precision and recall, and I can apply it to the confusion matrix that we had before. There is also the F1 measure, and the F1 measure is the harmonic mean, and that is computed like this. I will explain this in a minute, but the basic idea of the F1 measure is that both precision and recall should be good. If one of them is bad, then the F1 measure should also be bad. Because it's very easy to make a classifier that has a precision of 1 or that has a recall of 1. What is difficult is to come up with a classifier which is scoring good on both of them. And that's why we use the harmonic mean in the form of the F1 measure. This is indicating that, so the formula for the F1 measure is 2 times precision times recall divided by precision plus recall. So if you look at this, then for example, if precision is equal to 1 and recall is equal to 0, then we have 2 times 1 times 0 divided by 1 plus 0. So that is equal to 0. So the average of precision and recall is half, but the F1 measure is equal to 0. This is the same. If precision is 0, then F1 measure is by definition also 0. If both are half, then we have 2 times half divided by half plus half is equal to half. If we have 0.8 for precision and 2.0 for recall, we get this value. So what you see is that if both are good, then the result will be good. But if one of them is let's say close to zero, the result will also be very low. because all of these situations have a mean value of 0.5, but only in this middle scenario we actually have also an F1 measure, which is equal to 0.5. So that explains the F1 score, but it could also be that we have a good precision, good recall, good F1 score, so everything looks good. Well, in reality, it is not good at all, but it only looks good because our data is very skewed. So suppose that we have a data set where 99% is positive. Yeah, so if we have 100 instances, 99 is positive and 1 is negative. Then if we would build a decision tree or a neural network or an SVM model, it may be that that model always simply says positive. No matter what the input is, it always says positive. If we then look at the quality, then precision is equal to 99 divided by 99 plus 1. So precision is very, very high. Recall is even perfect. Yes, I just fill out the formulas that I had before. And if I now would compute the F1 score, it would also be a very high value. Right, so this illustrates the problem that, so if I would apply this to the situation, we would like to detect fraud. Almost never fraud occurs, and we simply always predict, okay, there is no fraud, then maybe our precision recall and F1 measure are very good. But in reality, we are not doing anything. We are not trying to predict whether there is fraud or not. So for that, there are more refined measures that, let's say, tackle this imbalancedness. One approach is to compute the average class accuracy. So we are computing the recall for all the different levels, it is called here, but these are all the possible values for the target feature. So we do 1 divided by the number of possible values for the target feature, and then we sum up over all the possible values for the target feature and we compute recall. And then classes, even if they have fewer instances, have the same weight. So if I apply that to our example, remember that before we had precision is 0.99, recall is 1. If we apply this formula, the average class accuracy is only 0.5. Because we treat both classes, the positive class and the negative class, equally, even though there are much more instances in the positive class than there are instances in the negative class. So we get this expression leading to a class accuracy of 0.5 rather than these values very close to 1. This is a combination of the two ideas. So here we are combining the idea of harmonic mean. And the idea of harmonic mean is that if one of the values is bad, the overall value should be bad. I'm combining that with let's say treating all the different classes equal, even though some classes may have few instances and other classes may have many instances. And if I fill out the formula, then it will even be the case, because we are very bad at detecting this 1%, because always we say it is positive, then we have this value. Note that here, but that's a technicality, 1 divided by a value very close to 0 leads to infinite, and that's why this term is equal to 0. But this is just a generalization of the principles that we had seen before. So I hope that this is clear, and it shows that we are trying to balance over the different classes, and we are trying to get a high penalty if either precision or recall is very bad. And this plot, this is showing the normal mean of precision and accuracy. This is showing the harmonic mean. and you can see you should look at these edges. Here we have a zero value, even though one of them is good and the other one is bad. If we don't take the harmonic mean, we would have a value of half. But I think this should be pretty clear. Sometimes we want to associate a value, so a cost or a benefit, to predicting certain things. And that the reasoning behind this is, for example, that not all errors are have a similar severity. So perhaps we sometimes, so it is more expensive to oversee a positive than it is to detect too many, let's say, false positives. So a nice example would be that if we look at self-driving cars, so it could be that there is a false positive where the car starts to brake, thinking that there is a kind of crash upcoming, and the crash does not happen. We can think of that as a false positive, but it is not very, very problematic, very severe. However, what is severe, if the car does not predict that an accident is going to happen and the accident happens. So that's a false negative. And so that would be much more costly than a car stopping once in a while too often. So that leads to the combination of a confusion matrix and a profit matrix. So here I'm taking an example from the book where I have two predictive models, one based on neural networks, the other one based on decision trees. These are the confusion matrices, and here I have a profit matrix. So I attach a positive value to the true positives, I attach zero value to the true negatives, and I attach, let's say, negative values to true false positives and false negatives. If I do that, then I multiply the numbers with this, and then I get these two matrices. And what we can see here is that in this example, using this profit matrix, the profit of the decision tree is higher. Although, if we look at the numbers, we would have thought that the neural network would be doing better, because there are 13 misclassifications here, there are 20 misclassifications here, but still the profit is better. And that is showing, let's say, the scenario that I just sketched. So the decision tree would score better taking into account the profit matrix. If we would not take into account the profit matrix, we would think that the neural network would perform better. Okay, I hope that this is clear so far. So one of the things that you should always keep in mind, also if you are taking, let's say, other courses from, let's say, our PATS group that involve, let's say, things like process discovery in the context of process mining, we should always be very clear, are we evaluating an algorithm or are we evaluating a model? And with a model, I refer to a specific decision tree, a specific process model, a specific logistic regression model, whatever. If we evaluate an algorithm, then we repeatedly, let's say, train different models using the algorithm. So the algorithm is fixed, but we have different models, and we evaluate these models. If we evaluate a model, we don't care about the algorithm, but we just have one predictive model, not several of them, and we are evaluating, let's say, the data on top of that model. Where we should always be careful, so even if data is observed, if the same data was used to create a model, we should be very careful for the reasons that I indicated before. But in this second scenario, like it is general, we are not evaluating an algorithm, we are evaluating a model. And so other factors that come into play. So it's not just evaluating an algorithm, There are also parameter settings, all kinds of configurations. We talked about the validation set, so you're aware that this is more complicated. There are specific scenarios where there are, let's say, also specific challenges. In the confusion matrix that we just showed, we assumed that there are positive examples and negative examples. However, there are data sets where we only see the positive examples. So for example, if we are trying to use process mining techniques to discover a model based on observed behavior, then we only see the observed behavior, so things that have actually happened. We never see, let's say, behavior that would not be possible, because if it's not possible, it is not being recorded. In some data sets, also if you look at classification examples, there is something called the survival bias. So it could be that the instances that are reported are not the actual set of instances that we start with, but there has been filtering, etc., etc., and only certain instances survived, making such analysis very, very risky. Yeah. So, the next topic is the receiver operating characteristic, short ROC curve. And this is addressing the situation that many, let's say, classification algorithms have a kind of threshold that we can set. And we can set it in such a way that, let's say, our precision is perfect, or we can set it in such a way that our recall is perfect. But it's very difficult to have something that is, let's say, having a good F1 score. And it's variable, because we can set the threshold, we can influence the result. So suppose that we have a neural network that we train with values 0 and 1, for example, true and false. But the neural network will return numbers like 0.2, 0.7. And then the question is, okay, how do we map 0.2 and 0.7 onto, let's say, true or false? And then we can set the threshold at 0.2, at 0.5, at 0.8, leading to different results. So this is best explained using, let's say, the example from the book. So suppose that we have a threshold of 0.5. So that means we have like a kind of score, and the score could come from logistic regression, could come from a neural network, and we say that if the score is above half, we predict it is spam, as you can clearly see. If the score is below 0.5, we predict it is not spam. So we can do this, and we can compute a confusion matrix, and you can see the four different labels: true negatives, false positives, and true positives, just as we have seen before. However, I chose to set the threshold at 0.5. I could also have moved this threshold to a higher value. For example, I could have set the threshold to 0.7. If I move this threshold, then this spam prediction becomes a ham prediction. So we do not predict there will be spam. And this false positive is turning, because it then says ham, turns from a false positive into a true negative. So if we move the threshold up, we get more true negatives, possibly also more false negatives, and less false positives and true positives. We could also change the threshold in the other direction. So for example, we could now change the threshold to 0.3. And if we do that, then our ham instance becomes a ham spam instance. So for instance 14, we predicted to be spam. So we were right before, but because we lowered the threshold, this true negative is turned into a false positive. So this shows that with the threshold, we can change these values. So before we saw the confusion matrix for 0.5, here I'm showing two other confusion matrices, one for threshold 0.25 and one for threshold 0.75. This is the table, and you can see, let's say, the three boundaries, so 0.25, half, 0.75, leading to different predictions. So here at the top, you can see we have predictions 10, 25, 50, 75, and 90, and the numbers change. So if we zoom in, so these are the different predictions for the different levels. So if you have a prediction of 0.10, our threshold is here, and everything above 10, 0.10, is predicted to be spam. So that means that that we get relatively many false positives. In many cases, we predict it to be spam. Well, it's not spam at all. If I look at the last column, then the threshold is 0.9. So all of these values are not predicted to be spam. So our ability to detect spam becomes, let's say, very limited. If I scroll down, then only, let's say, two instances we predict that there is spam because the threshold is above 0.9. So that leads to these different, let's say, quality characteristics, where we can look at the misclassification rate, true positive rate, true negative rate, and all the things that we have seen before. So, for example, what we see here is that for this middle value, we indeed had the best classification rate of 0.75. So this is showing the trade-off. So we have a threshold on the x-axis, and on the y-axis, I'm plotting the value for the true positive rate that starts high and ends low, and the true negative rate, which starts low and ends high. So if we set the threshold to zero, everything is predicted to be positive. We get, let's say, a high value for this. If we set the threshold equal to 1, and so very high, we see that this number goes down to 0. The true negative rate is exactly the opposite. If we set the threshold very high, we basically never predict spam, and that leads to, let's say, this value of 1 here, because our false positives will become 0, the same as here our false negatives would become 0 if we are here on this end of the spectrum. So just fill out some values and you will understand what I mean. What is clear is that by setting the threshold, I'm basically changing the balance between the true negative rate and the true positive rate. This is visualizing this in a different way. So look at this red circle. These are the instances for which we predict that it is spam, for example. So we predict them to be positive. If we make the circle smaller, then this is the impact on the different measures that we have. If we make the circle bigger, then these are the things that are happening to the different numbers that we have. So for example, if we look at the true negative rate, if I make this circle smaller, then what you will see is that Tn is increasing, Fp is decreasing. And that is why this value is going up, because this number is getting smaller and the Tn value is getting bigger. If we look at this one, making the circle bigger, then we are basically increasing this value, Fp, and we are decreasing Tn, and that leads to this value going down. So this is, I think, all fairly clear and obvious that this is happening. So we have this trade-off. So here I'm going back to the example that I've been using before, and now you kind of can see the curve that is being plotted here, where I'm plotting TPR, so the true positive rate. And so these are the instances, the fraction of instances that are positive, that are also classified as positive. I'm plotting that on the y-axis. On the x-axis, I'm plotting the false positive rate. And it's a bit confusing because that is 1 minus the value that we have here, but that is just a convention of showing the ROC curve, but the meaning should be clear. So this is equal to the number of false positives divided by all the negative instances. And here you can see three confusion matrices, and you can see the corresponding numbers. So, as I said, it's a bit misleading because on the one hand we are taking this value, and this is the value that we show here is 1 minus TNR. Yeah, so this is 0.8, and we do 1 minus 0.8 is the 0.2 that we see here. A bit confusing, but if you just look at the model on the right, it should be clear. So if I, let's say, just pick the model that I just showed on the right-hand side, then we are plotting TPR versus FPR. And in the ideal scenario, our TPR is equal to 1, and our FPR is equal to 0. So this is the point where we would like to be. And this is the, let's say, the worst point. So that's the point where our true positive rate is equal to 0 and our false positive rate is equal to 1. So we do not want to be here, we want to be here. And the more we are in this corner, the better. So let us now look at these two points. And I think they are very important to be understood properly. So if we have, if we predict all to be false, so we are looking at the classifier and we predict everything false, so we never detect spam. If we do that, then our number of false positives, because we never predict anything to be positive, is of course equal to 0. Our true positives, however, are also 0. So Fp is 0 and Tp are 0. So if Tp is equal to 0, then of course this is equal to 0. And if Fp is equal to 0, then of course we are also here. So if we predict all to be false, we are always at this point, by definition. Now let's just take a look at this point. Suppose that we predict always true. So for every message, we will predict this is a spam message. Then, symmetric to the situation before, we never predict anything to be negative, so our true negatives is equal to 0 and our false negatives are equal to 0. Yeah, so we never, we predict all to be false, so every message is a spam message, and if we fill out the numbers, so now Tn is equal to 0, if the n is equal to 0, then this formula, so then we have fp divided by fp plus 0 is equal to 1. If fn is equal to 0, as we indicate here, then this term is equal to 0. So we have tp divided by tp plus 0 is equal to tp divided by tp is equal to 1. So here, lots of words, but I think it's pretty clear that if we predict all to be false or all to be true, we are in these extremes. And what we now would like to be is we don't want to be here, we don't want to be here, we would like to be in this corner. So what is now, where do we now set the threshold to kind of to get into this corner as much as possible? It is clear that there is a trivial way of, let's say, on average, being on this line. And so this part of the graph is in a way uninteresting because you need to have an incredibly stupid prediction model that you would have values ending up here. Why would you need to have like an incredibly stupid algorithm to end up with values here? Because randomly guessing will lead to this line. I will explain that in a second. We would like to be here. So here is stupid, is negative. On the line is, let's say, if we don't use any information and we just randomly pick things, we would like to be as close to this area as possible. So I just made the statement, if we just guess we are on this line, and I can now prove this. So suppose that we have a data set where the fraction q is actually positive, and that means that the fraction 1 minus q is negative. So we do not know this, and this is hidden. So there is a fraction q that is positive and 1 minus q is negative. So this is the actual data. And now we need to make a prediction, and we make a purely random prediction, and we just throw, let's say, a dice or throw a coin, and we assume that with probability p, an instance is positive, and with probability 1 minus p, it is negative. Independent of whether it is actually positive or negative. So what we predict and what is the actual value are independent of each other. So what is now the probability of having a true positive? The probability of having a true positive is that the instance is actually positive and we predict it to be positive. So that is a fraction p times q. So the fraction of true positives is equal to p times q. So for example, if half of them is positive and we predict with half, then we get half times half is 1/4 as the probability or the fraction where we predict true positives. True negatives is exactly the other way around. So in reality, it is negative and we predict it to be negative. That's what we see here. And fp and fn can be computed in the same way. Note that here, if I'm multiplying these, I'm multiplying probabilities or fractions, whatever way that you interpret it. So I'm not really talking about numbers, but if you want, you can multiply this with the actual number of instances to not get fractions, but to get, let's say, real numbers of instances being classified as tp, tn, fp, and fn. Yeah? So I just guess randomly, and assuming independence, that leads to these probabilities. And now, interestingly, I can compute tpr. So tpr is equal to tp divided by tp plus fn. And now I have expressions either in numbers or in probabilities for all of these terms. So I get this. And if you look here, then we have p times q plus 1 minus p times Q. So this lower part is equal to Q. Then we have P times Q divided by Q is of course equal to P. So that is surprising. It seems that the value of Q doesn't play a role. If we look at FPR, then we have this expression FP divided by TN plus FP. Again, I fill out the values. Note that I have 1 minus P times this term plus P times this term. So I can reduce the lower half to 1 minus Q. I can remove this and this, and that also leads to P. So the TPR and the FPR do not depend at all on the actual fraction of what is positive and what is negative. And this is, let's say, very surprising that that doesn't play a role. But it is showing that for any choice of P, it's something that we can choose, what is the fraction where we randomly predict it to be positive or not. Based on this, we get our points on the line. Because for any setting of P, we have a point here on this diagonal. So this is what you trivially get by guessing. And if you are below this line, you're doing worse than random guessing. And that's, of course, something that that an algorithm should not do. So if we here compare, if we have an algorithm and we have different settings, so for example, the threshold that we were varying before, then a typical shape is like the shape that you see here on the left-hand side. We can choose different settings and in that way balance, let's say, the two types of errors that we can make. And ideally, we are as close to this point as possible. And if you now compare, let's say here, the four models that are shown in this diagram, then it is clear that model one is outperforming all the other ones. Because no matter where we set the parameter, it is always performing better. Yeah. So the area under the curve, so under this line, where we know that by default we are already on the diagonal if we are randomly guessing, the area under the curve is the area that we would like to maximize. And so the bigger the yellow part, the better. So we are computing this line. If this fills the whole square, we have a perfect score. If it fills, let's say, less than half, we have something that is very bad. Anything above this line is considered to be positive. So there is this formula that you can also find in the book to compute this. So I'm going to explain how this is being computed. T is, let's say, the number of steps that we have on this diagonal. And we look at all the, we go from this to this, from this to this, from this to this, from this to this, from this to this. And that corresponds to this I. That I think is clear. Then what we can do to look at this, if we look at this diagonal, we can basically take our distance in the x dimension and take the average of these two points and get something like this. So I'm not now going to show that. So our steps on the x-axis are the same as before. But if we now look at the y-axis, we are taking the average of two points, right? So for this, let's say, square, we take the distance on the x-axis and we take the middle value of these two points that we have here. And now we compute this area. So if I point that out, so this term that we are looking at here are the steps that we have on the x-axis. This term here, divided by 2, is taking the average of, let's say, 2 values. And we repeat that for every step, and then we get the area, the part colored in yellow that we had before. So a good algorithm is maximizing this, and this way we can also reason about algorithms that have a certain threshold where we swap, let's say, from predicting positive to predicting negative. So far, we have been looking at categorical data where we had just, let's say, 2 possible values, true, false, positive, negative, etc. All of the concepts can be generalized to, let's say, the situation where we have more than 2 possible values. Here you see an example. So again, we can draw a confusion matrix that doesn't really change. So we have the real values. There are 4 possible real values. There are the same 4 values that we can predict. The numbers on the diagonal are good. Everything that is not on the diagonal is not good. And we are trying to maximize the numbers on the diagonal and trying to minimize the numbers that are not on the diagonal. We can talk about precision and recall, and you can interpret them as, let's say, columns in this diagram. So, for example, if we look at this first row here, we see that there, in reality, are 7 having this value, and we predict only in 5 of these cases that actually this value is there. So that leads to a recall value of 0.7. If we look in the precision dimension, then we predict in 5 cases that it has this value, and we are always right. So there is a precision of 1. I can highlight, let's say, a particular column. So for example, if you look at this column, it's more interesting because, let's say, like we see here something in every row. What we see is that we predict in total 15 times that it has this class. But only in 10 of these 15 times we are right. So that leads to a precision of 10 divided by 15 is 0.66. If we look at this row, then we are looking at recall. So there are 11 instances that actually have this value, and in 10 of them we predict the right one. So we get 10 divided by 10 plus 1 is 11, leads to 0.9 as a recall value. So it's absolutely trivial to extend all the ideas to, let's say, having more than 2 possible values. If we look at continuous target values, then it's very similar to what we have been working with in the context of regression and neural networks. So you are very familiar with the notion of the sum of squared errors. This is a bit of a technical definition because we often use this formula because it has such a nice derivative. The interpretation is not directly clear, but of course we would like to minimize this term. We would like to minimize the difference between the real value and the predicted value. We square it in such a way that whether it is above, at the difference is positive or negative, that is, let's say, filtered out because we take it to the power 2. We've seen this before, I think that should be clear. So we take the difference between the actual value, the predictive value. The predictive value is based on the, let's say, descriptive features that we are using as input, and then we apply this formula. We can take the mean squared error, that is, rather than dividing by 2, we divide by the number of instances. also something that we have seen before, very similar. We can take the root mean squared error. That is typically easier to interpret. This is, let's say, comparable to the difference between variance and standard deviation. This would correspond to standard deviation. We can also look at the mean absolute error. I think this is the measure which one can interpret easy. So we always take the difference between the target value and the predicted value. Whether it's positive or negative, we do not care in which direction the error goes. That's why we take the absolute value and we divide by the number of instances. So this is the average error, and this is the thing that is most easy to understand. The drawback of this metric, just like the other ones, is of course that the error is an absolute error. So it may say, okay, the mean absolute error is 0.05, but what does it actually mean? So that is why there is the R squared coefficient that you see here, which looks at the following measure. We take 1 minus the sum of squared errors, that's what we see here, divided by the total sum of squares. And the total sum of squares is we take the difference between Ti and the average value. Let's just assume that our model is predicting the average value. So we would like to predict the target value, and we use a very naive predictor. We simply ignore all the descriptive features and we just predict the average. If we do that, then this is the same as that. And then we have 1 minus an expression divided by another expression, and both are the same. So we have 1 minus 1 divided by 1 is equal to 0. So then the R square is equal to 0 if we just guess the average. If the variation is very big, so the predicted the values are, let's say, highly variable. So we have an average, but typically we are very far off the average. Then we are dividing by a large number. If we have a good predictor, then this predictor is much closer to the actual value rather than the average. So then we divide a small number by a large number. So in the limit, this is going to 0, and that would lead to an R square of 1. So R square of 1 means that we are making very good predictions. R squared of 0 means we are not better than guessing the overall average. And that is what is listed on this slide. So an R square value of 0 implies that one is not better than the baseline, being simply predict the average. R squared of 1 means that all predictions are perfect. So what you see here is we compare the R squared value with the measures that we had before, is that it becomes easier to interpret because it's a relative value on the scale of 0.0 to 1 rather than some absolute number that we do not know how to interpret. Of course, these continuous target variables can be combined with all the cross-validation methods that we had before. So there is nothing new there. So before, we were using confusion matrices, precision recall, but we can also use the R-square value or any of the other values that I showed you before. Nothing new. Two topics are remaining, A-B testing and concept drift. So the first topic, A-B testing, means that we are trying to turn predictions in recommendations, but if we are following a recommendation, we are changing the real world. And that makes it, let's say, a bit tricky. So supervised learning can be used to turn data into predictive models. So for example, we can predict that there will be some kind of problem, or that we can predict that there will be some kind of success. And then based on this prediction, we can take certain actions. For example, generating a recommendation. And then the idea is that this recommendation leads to a change of what we predicted. Ideally, if we predict that there is a problem, we generate a recommendation to circumvent from happening what we predicted. But the question is whether this recommendation is actually, let's say, working properly. And so, if we predict, for example, you're taking this course and based on, I don't know, your behavior during the course, we predict that you will fail, we could generate, let's say, an alert that hopefully makes you change your working style. These are the types of things where we are trying to influence reality. Of course, if we generate recommendations and we are trying to influence reality, what is very important is to understand what is cause and effect, distinguishing causality from correlations. We should also know the direction, and we should know what are now the things that we can control and what are the things that we cannot control. So, for example, as it states here, wealthy people drive Porsches, so let's buy a Porsche and then we are wealthy. Or if I wear sunglasses, it will not rain, because I observe that when people are wearing sunglasses, it does not rain. So, of course, all of these things are nonsense. We can all see that. But they show that that this is tricky. So it is well known that correlation does not imply causality, and there are many cartoons illustrating this, like the one that you see here. Here you see another funny one that is, say, using time as a proxy for, let's say, causality. So if something happens before something else, then we tend to think that the thing that happened before is influencing the other thing. So here you have a graph that is showing, let's say, how many people have cancer, how many people have cell phones, and then people could conclude that cancer is causing the use of cell phones. Well, this is of course not the case. So these cartoons make you aware a bit of the issues. One of the things, if you start modeling, let's say, these causalities in causal modeling, things that typically are, let's say, very tricky, are so-called hidden variables that have an effect on multiple other variables. And because the hidden variable has effect on multiple other variables, you start thinking that these variables influence each other. So for example, if you look at the first bullet point here, if the sun is shining, then that may lead to increased ice cream sales, and it may lead to increased burglary, because people are not breaking into houses when it is minus 20 degrees centigrade. So the weather is influencing two variables, and that may lead to the conclusion that by eating more ice cream, people get more criminal, which is of course not the case because there is this hidden variable. Another example, so they are not really serious, but just to make the point, so using an umbrella leads to higher walking speeds. If it's raining, people tend to use an umbrella, and if it's raining, people tend to work much faster on the street than they would if the sun is shining and the weather is very pleasant. So again, a hidden variable is influencing two other variables causing the problem. So what A/B testing is about is to kind of eliminate these types of effects. So you want to see what the effect of a certain recommendation is. And the only way that you can find out is by actually random testing, called A/B testing. So you have, let's say, two variants, A and B. Yeah? For example, two websites or two different recommendations that are being produced. And then you compare the performance of these two variants. Yeah? So for example, if you are predicting that somebody will do something, and you are thinking about a certain intervention, then you can, by doing A/B testing, you can see whether that intervention has actually a positive effect. So for example, in the setting of process mining, we have encountered situations where we see that there is a problem in a process. We can predict when this problem occurs. So there are good predictive models to predict, for example, that somebody is going to raise an objection based on the behavior before, then we can make an intervention. But what we have sometimes seen is that by making these interventions, although based on our predictive models, we think it will lead to an improvement, in reality, doing the intervention leads to even more problems. So this is something that you should be very careful about. Because if you let people follow a recommendation, the process that you were using to base the predictions on is no longer the same. Things may be very different. So that's A/B testing. Another topic where I can be brief on, because I think it's pretty obvious, and we already partly touched that, is that data has a time component. So whatever data we look at, it was gathered at a particular point in time. And if there are seasonal effects, or there is a certain steady increase, then we should be very careful if we are, let's say, making predictions or making conclusions about the data. So for example, here you see the sales of ice cream that I also used before as an example. This changes over time. So whenever we are building models and we are using these models for predictions or interventions or whatever we want to do with these models, we should be very aware of these effects. This is another example. For example, if you are in the insurance business, you realize that, let's say, things are rarely in steady state, and there is this drift that is influencing the actual behavior of customers, and you should take that into account. These are just random graphs showing that if you look at the temporal dimension of data, that it is changing over time. So here you see, let's say, you could try to make all kinds of predictive models. I don't know which patients to operate, what is the survival probability of certain, let's say, patients, etc., etc. And here you can see that over time, let's say, there may be, let's say, major differences due to, let's say, contextual factors. This is another example where you can just see that there is a steady change over time. And now think of building neural networks, think of building decision trees, and you're making a prediction now for the future. These kind of trends should somehow be taken into account. There is a measure, there are actually many measures to kind of test stability and to test for concept drift. This is a very simple model. You can also do, let's say, hypothesis testing. So for example, you can phrase the hypothesis, nothing is changing, and then you try to reject that hypothesis because of a low p-value. You can do it in ways like this. This is a very simple measure, which is basically using the formula where I take the difference between two values and I take the natural logarithm of the fraction of these two. And then that leads to certain values, and then you can say, an intuitive interpretation, if this value is zero, lower than 0.1, we say there is no significant drift. If it's more than 0.25, we say that there is significant drift. In the middle, there is moderate drift. And here you can see the different levels, so the different categories that are there. This is what was there in the previous period or in my training data. This is what is actually observed. Then we can compute this factor for all the different levels or all the different classes, and that leads to this value. So here we could conclude that this is that there is no significant drift in the data. This is showing a plot. So this was the original distribution. And here I'm comparing all the different samples with respect to the original distribution. So here in a certain period, I'm looking at the distribution. And although it is different, I don't, let's say, generate an alert using the system stability index. If I look at the sample here, which has a distribution like that, I can compute the numbers and it would lead to the indication that there is actually a drift because we are above this threshold indicated here. This is just to let's say explain let's say the notion of concept drift, and that you can also capture that in terms of numbers. If we take a step back, then if we are evaluating results, like the bottom line is that you can only evaluate, let's say, supervised learning approaches based on unseen data. And that is the gold standard, and that's the only thing that we can do. Next to the quality of the prediction, so the quality of prediction here, I refer to things like F1 score and also the more refined measures that I gave on unseen data. This is the quality, as we have seen it before. There is a kind of other dimension, and that is the dimension of explainability. What we have argued before is that if you look at a neural network, it may work perfectly well on the data that you're testing it on, but you do not completely understand how it works. So in some situations, you may want to opt for a much simpler decision tree that has a, let's say, poorer performance, but that people can understand and that people trust. So these are the kind of trade-offs that we showed before. So a decision tree is very clear what it means. If we look at the regression formula, then it's also very clear. We see what the effect of rainfall is, for example. If you think about a neural network that has millions of neurons, all and connected through connections that have different weights, it is very difficult to understand why a particular image is classified as a dog or not. Of course, there is progress in the area of explainable AI, but the bottom line remains that these models are not as interpretable as decision trees or regression formulas. If you, for example, would have a neural network as a judge that decides whether people are guilty or not, and suppose that based on all kinds of test data, like there is confidence that, let's say, this neural network judge is making good decisions, then you would still not accept that the neural network says you have to go to jail for 10 years without giving a clear argumentation. So this is this trade-off that I explained before, the same not just in if you think about judges, but also if you think about doctors. that need to make, let's say, difficult decisions, even if neural networks and very sophisticated models can help in, let's say, making that decision much better, in the end it has to be explainable, otherwise people will not accept this. So I hope that this helped you to better understand how to evaluate these supervised learning techniques. The bottom line and the most important thing is that cross-validation is essential. Never just trust training data, because as the statement says here, is you can torture the data until it tells you what you want it to tell, but you need to always test it on unseen data. It's also important to limit the number of hypotheses that you're generating. This is an example that I gave earlier. If you are testing dozens of hypotheses, you need to accept that just by accident, some of these hypotheses will not be rejected. And that is something that you should bear in mind. This is a survey of the different concepts discussed. Confusion matrices, F1 score, precision recall. You should be able to compute to draw the ROC curve. You should be able to compute the area under the curve. If we go to continuous variable, you should, let's say, know all these different measures that I explained. And you should be aware of both the possibility there is drift in the data, and that if you are making recommendations, you're also changing reality, and perhaps your predictive model is no longer valid. If you want to read more, look at chapter 8 of this book. So this is showing where we stand now. So we have seen all the, let's say, standard supervised learning techniques. We have now evaluated them, or at least showed how you could evaluate them. In the next couple of lectures, we are going to look at unsupervised learning techniques. So these are settings where we do not have a target value, and we just want to find patterns, to find structure in the data, structures that we do not know that they actually exist. So we will start with clustering, then go to frequent item sets, learning different types of rules, onto the topic of automatically learning processes based on event data. See you next time.